this atmosphere. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Real simple song. I want to teach it to you tonight. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. I will wait on you. Yes, I will trust in you. Yes, Lord, say it. I will trust in you. Y'all help me. The Lord is my light. Everybody sing. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Don't say it. Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? I will wait on you. Yeah. Say it again. Say. I will trust in you. Yeah. Say. I will trust in you.
The next part goes like this. Listen, I want you to go home singing this.
I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Oh, Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Please join with me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, you may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. The first lesson is going to be coming from Exodus chapter 20. And it goes, then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other God before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is seen in heaven, above, or that is on the earth, beneath or in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that your Lord God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, male or female slave, ox, donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church.
Good
morning. The lesson today is coming from Matthew's chapter 21, verses 33 through 46. Hear the word of the Lord. Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. When the harvest time approached, he sent his servant to the tenant to collect his fruit. The tenant seized his servant. They beat him, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them, more than the first time, and the tenant treated them the same way. Last of all, he sent his son to them, and he said, they will respect my son, he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him and take his inheritance. So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? He will bring those wretches to a wretched inn, they replied, and he will rent the vineyard to other tenants who will give him his share of the crop at harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scripture, the stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone? The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce it fruit. Anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone on whom it falls will be crushed. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parable, they knew he was talking about them. They looked for a way to arrest him, but they were afraid of the crowd because the people held that he was a prophet. The word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Okay, I'm going to lead off by saying some of you know this, some of you do not, that I am more of a numbers person than a reading person. So I'm going to be a little challenged here, but give it my best shot. But I do have the distinct pleasure of introducing our guest speaker for today. And he's none other than Dr. Uday Mark Balasundaram, and he is an indigenous cosmopolitan residing in Durham, North Carolina, with his wife Sujatha and their two teenage daughters. Sujatha is a visual artist, theologian. He has developed and taught courses in liturgical studies, spiritual formation, and advanced course of study programs. Uday was born in Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu in South India, and brought up amid social, cultural tensions and political turmoil in the 1970s and the 1980s, New Delhi. He went to Catholic school and attended a Methodist church. His appreciation for Indian and Western classical music began at home. Uday learned guitar from a young age and graduated with a certificate in guitar performance from the Musicians Institute in Los Angeles. He worked in public media for about 10 years, composing music for advertising, theaters, contemporary dance, and as a sessions guitarist with A.R. Rahman in Bollywood film music industry. Uday received a Master's of Divinity and PhD from Asbury Theological Seminary in Wilmore, Kentucky, and has served in several pastoral and worship leader roles in diverse churches in the U.S. and India. He is an arts catalyst with the Lusayan Movement, teaching adjunct with the Center for Excellence in World Arts at Dallas International University. He has previously taught courses at Fuller Theological Seminary in Houston Graduate School of Theology, and SAIACS, Bangalore. Uday's current research and writing are in creative theology, innovation, and the arts. He's the author of Creativity and Captivity, exploring the process of creativity amongst indigenous cosmopolitans for Mission, series number 51, American Society of Missionology. In addition, Uday is creativity consultant and serves on the board of the Association of Professors of Mission and the board of Samadhan, New Delhi, an NGO serving persons with intellectual disabilities and impacted by poverty. After we hear a selection from the new creation male chorus, the next voice you will hear will be Uday. Thank you.
Thank you. to understand. I can still trust in your name. Trust in your name. Show yourself mighty, mighty. Show yourself mighty in me. Show yourself mighty, mighty. Show yourself. When the rain seems to pour, when I can't take no more, show yourself mighty in me. You are my God, you cannot fail, you cannot lie, you must prevail. Oftentimes, we find ourselves in situations that are simply overwhelming. Situations that are totally beyond our control. We don't have the money, the knowledge, the strength, nor the resources that we need to overcome. And that's when we need the Lord our God to step in and show himself mighty, make us more than we really are. So Lord, this is what I want you to do for me. Show yourself mighty, mighty. Show yourself.
Thank you so much for the beautiful. I want to invite us to maybe just stand as we kind of not only transition to hear the word of God proclaimed through preaching, but also maybe just to stretch and relax. Right? Well, thank you. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for the reminder in song, God, of your might. It's amazing, oh God. And oh Lord, we just seem to have such a small idea of it, Lord, so often. And this morning we cry out, oh Lord, to you. And ask, oh God, that you would open our eyes, oh Lord. That you would open our hearts, oh Lord, on this Men's Sunday, oh Lord, especially for the men of this church, oh Lord. The men of our cities, oh Lord. And each and every person here in this congregation, oh God. Oh God, come and have your way. Let your might be evident in us and through us. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you. In one of the slides, I saw that, Lester, you're going to be teaching a class on communion, right? Yeah, and I think that's a wonderful opportunity. I just wanted to highlight that, if that's okay with you. If you want to take maybe 30 seconds to say what that's about, because, you know, I had this, we talk a lot with Lester and Bede, and I was saying, hey, when communion starts somehow, since we do it so often, I kind of switch off sometimes when the liturgy is going on. I don't know about you, maybe that doesn't happen to you. But then he got talking, and Lester had this suggestion, you know what? Let's think about how we do this differently. And I'm so happy that you're doing this class, so maybe take
it. Sure. So, long story short, I'll be using both the Bible and history and our own worship resources and opening the pathway to heaven as we think of what's absolutely essential about the table and what might be changed in creative ways.
Amen. That's great. Thanks so much. And yeah, we'll be kind of rounding up what I have to say with communion this morning again. And as I just want to say thank you, Eugene, for the invitation. Thank you, men, for having me. I consider it an extreme privilege that you've asked me to present to you the Word of God. Of course, for being God's Word, but also on this special day when we remember who we are as a church, especially through the ministry of men. And I'd like for us to think about, you know, as we kind of listen to this, you know, what does it really mean to be a man in today's world, right? I mean, what are your thoughts on that? What does it mean to be a man in today's world? Because everywhere I go, I find only partial and in most cases pathetic responses to the question of what it means to be a man in this world, albeit with a ring of truth. Now, here are three not intended to be all-encompassing kind of illustrations, but somewhat representative of popular culture, what the world teaches us, right? And we have this whole idea of the myth of man, the achiever, right? Living the American dream. It's all about this outward ability to go out and build it and take control of your life, you know, have that family, have that car, have your house, have your possessions, and you're in control for the pursuit of happiness, the pursuit of freedom, finding opportunity, living out your passion, whatever you want, you can go out and build it and live the dream, right? In Maasai society, I remember my friend back in seminary from the tribe, and he told me how they, when they would come off age as men, one of the things that they would have to do is go out and kill a lion, so to speak. Now, they don't do that anymore. Actually, you're not supposed to kill a lion, but that's what traditionally they would do. And he said when he grew up, when he was about a young teenager, you know, he would gather with his friends, and they were, in one season of their life, set out on this mission to go kill a lion. And how do you do it? You know, you come together, you sleep together, you live together, you plan, and then you go out and you try and accomplish this amazing feat, and you come back, and then you're given the marks of a man, right? On your body, on your flesh, you have those marks. Now you are a man. Now you can represent the values of this tribe. All of our cultures have it, right? Today, somehow, the church has lost that capacity for ritual, maybe for men, and I'm glad we're kind of doing this, right? What it really means to be a grown-up adult, we have, you know, whether it's smoking a cigarette, whether it's having your first drink, or having your first fling, or getting your driver's license, we have all sorts of other ways in which kind of people cross the line into maturity, so to speak. The second myth is man, the provider, right? This usually refers to man working tirelessly to provide, providing for the needs of the family is endorsed, as we know in 1 Timothy, right? 5:8, if a man doesn't provide for his family, unless his relatives and friends, he's, you know, not living the way Christ wants him to live the life. But the idea of being a provider rests in the ability to see with insight, actually, that word, right? The man or Jehovah Jireh, right, that we used, is the ability to see with insight and interest, to observe closely in order to understand. As we see in Genesis 41:33, where the title is used for Yahweh, right? And that verse in Genesis 41:33, now let Pharaoh select a discerning and wise man and set him over the land of Egypt. Now that process of selection is the same title used for Yahweh as Yahweh, the provider. You know, you got to see what is the need over here. And the third is, you know, man the accessory. And this was a recent one that was all across our popular culture. In fact, man the accessory is characterized today as how I'm thinking about it is by Ken Carson in the latest Barbie film. Now, I'm not endorsing you go out and watch the film, or I'm not endorsing it, but here's what he says. You know, you have, you know, Barbie the doll, and then you have Ken Carson, who's the guy they came up with 2 years later, since they invented Barbie, to be more inclusive, right? But here's what Ken says in the film. You know, it doesn't seem to matter what I do. I'm always number two. You know, Barbie's latest storyline features Ken's struggle as an accessory to Barbie, right? And people say, hey, that's not what a man is. I mean, you know, you don't have to go bow down and, you know, to women all the time. For some critics, it reveals the challenge for men to find their place in a world where Barbie has excellent days. Each day is a great day. But Ken has only great days when she pays attention to him. Men face a crisis. I know, I grew up in a men's, a boys' school, all boys' school, so in New Delhi. By the way, Heath, thanks. You were very courageous in trying to read my my bio out. My bad. I think I didn't send a more simplified one. I think that was written for my academic, introduction somewhere, and you managed to use that, but that's okay. But anyway, that being aside, you know, I grew up in a boys' school, and right next to the boys' school was girls' school, right? As men growing up, you know, one thing, I mean, we may not say we're wired, you know, around what women want, but we're certainly wired, you know, by their presence in our lives a lot of times, especially in our worlds in schools and colleges, right? You see this happening. Where do people get their sense of what it means to be a man from, right? Or a woman from, for that matter? And if all that we have is these, stereotyped kind of images that popular culture offers us, you know, we're kind of lost, and men face a crisis. And here I have Jonathan Higgins, who writes on the blog On Being. It's an NPR blog, a very popular one. And he says, men often have to look outside of themselves for their first definition of what it means to be a man. So much so that it often leaves men in a dark and sad state of existence. But as men in Christ, what are the options are we offering people to understand their identities? Higgins, himself, a black and queer man, writes, I can remember hearing conversations between my mother and uncles about how fearful they were for me because I didn't exhibit the behaviors of masculinity. I was emotionally available, somewhat shy, and enjoyed connecting with people on a deeper level. And somehow that was seen as effeminate. And the men in my family worked tirelessly to, quote unquote, make me harder, a common rhetoric used in the black cis male community. Cis male is basically another word for saying the biological birth you were born with. If you're born man, you know, that's your practice. You are a male, as opposed to transgender, right? So you may be born one gender, but you kind of affirm a different gender identity. So according to Higgins, we must first unlearn what it means to be a man in our society's standards. And the world teaches us to understand what man is, actually from a biological, from a psychological, and a lot of it from a human sexuality perspective, right? However, I would go a step further. Our attempt to unlearn what it means to be a man in our society must first rest in our rediscovery of what it means to be a human in God's creative economy. That comes first. As we will see, there is more to our humanity than what it means to be a man, actually, or a woman, than what it means to be a black or white or brown man or woman, or whatever other color might be associated with our cultural perceptions of our masculinity. And we have to, I think we are in a place where we're struggling in the US because all of our conceptualizations and expressions of identity, if I'm a male, I'm speaking as a South Asian man, racist, or a black man, or a white man, or you know these identities. And I think we're all looking and struggling for a way, how does all this come together? Well, it's not going to come together if all we have is you see me as a South Asian man, or if I see myself as a South Asian man, or a black man. We're going to have to come to the same page. And I believe the Bible is just such an amazing document and story that invites us to transcend our own self-perceptions of who we are as black, brown, and white, as male, even. Okay? Now, I don't want to go into the nuances of that. Obviously, we don't have time and place to talk about gender and human sexuality, although we can and we must find those times and moments, right? But we shouldn't overlook the inequities that are related to our perceptions of colors or status. That's not what I'm calling for. I believe there are certain inequities that need to be addressed and need to be owned up to and that we are responsible to, right? But our human-inspired understandings of the colors of humanity, as long as they are rooted in the corrupt imagination of mankind, will grow dim in the light of the glory and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Our capacities to unlearn the wrong thing and relearn the way of God are not value-free. They are bounded by our inherited and adopted stereotypes, by what we have learned, and we will go around in circles unless we look to the Word of God, I believe, the center of our creative being in Christ. And there is no one or nothing else that can take up that position, right? Not your father, not your mother, not your sister, not your brother, not your man, not your woman, not your job, not your boss, not your church, not yourself. None of these but the cross of Christ. And this morning we are confronted with the man who went to the cross, who put himself in the center of it all because he is at the center of it all. All space and time, Jesus Christ comes as a fulfillment of whatever we want to think or imagine ourselves, right? But as soon as we try and recenter, we fall because we cannot on our own. What we can do is decenter first. Then by turning around 360, and we have a word for that in the Bible, and it is called repentance. Right? That's all it means, turn around 360. We make our way in the light of the glory of Christ. Right? And that is good news this morning, people of God. That is great news, right? Let's just relax in that. Say, you know what, Lord? I'm a man, I'm a woman. I've been thinking first that I'm a South Asian man and that I must do something about it. I'm thinking that I'm a black man. I'm thinking that I'm a white man. Oh, Lord, hallelujah, for you are the Son of Man. Come in glory, O Lord Jesus, God. And I want to rest my case before you, Lord Jesus. Will you give me a new perspective, a new insight, an understanding, O Lord, of what it means to be a man of God, O Lord? A man of God who loves the Lord God with all my heart, with all my soul, and with all my mind. And the decisive victory, I believe, is won when we refuse the armor of the king, just like David did on the battle. You know, those decisive moments in your life? Before he kind of won Goliath, he had to win that battle first. I'm not going to wear this armor. I'm just going to go it myself. And I think that's the battle we are in, men of God. God's calling you to step into your own. And that's where it lies, the crossing line, here and now, right here in front of us. And that's what I want to do today, every day, every moment. No holding back anymore. Anymore. We are in a mess in the world. People are looking for answers. Whether it's climate change, whether it's political, whether it's whatever, there are men of God who are holding back when we have the keys to the kingdom of God. As we will read in our passage, which, by the way, I didn't read, but I will get to it. Right? I started off by asking, who's a man of God? And the way that I came to respond to that prompt was by another question, and it is this: whose son are you? That's the biblical approach, I believe. And my inspiration as I looked through the scriptures was Matthew chapter 22, verses 41 to 46. If you have your Bibles or you have your phone, I want to invite you to take it up and we kind of read that together. I'm not sure if you can pull it up on the screen over there, but here it is, Matthew chapter 22. Now we know the context over here is towards the end of Jesus' ministry. It comes in the third kind of thematic flow of Matthew. The first is, you know, the early ministry, the genealogy of Christ. The second is the early ministry with the disciples. And the third is when Jesus now began to tell people who he really was and what he was here for, that he was going to go, he was going to be crucified and suffer at the hands of, you know, Pilate, and delivered up to die. Right? And it's in that context that he's talking to the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which were, you know, and in that context, in Matthew chapter 22, we read verse 41. Right? Now, just preceding the context, right, he's been talking to the Pharisees about paying taxes to Caesar, and the Sadducees, you know, had asked him this trick question that we'll take a look at very quickly. But now the Pharisees were sticklers for the Mosaic law, which was, the Pharisees were a separatist movement. They were focused on purity and doing the right thing at the right time, the right way, right? And Jesus thought they were kind of malicious. He considered them, I mean, knowing the truth, you know, you affirm, unlike the Sadducees, the resurrection. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection, right? So maybe you can give out a little rope. But with the Pharisees, he was a little more sticky. Yeah, but together, the Pharisees and the Sadducees represent the problems for Jesus. You know, on the one hand, the structural change, and the underlying systems change from which are birthed ideologies and the customs and the traditions, right? So for any lasting progress, changes need to be made on both fronts, as we know. Just by changing and rearranging the chairs, nothing's going to happen. We're going to have to change the underlying system that we believe in, the ideologies, right? And so naturally, we see the Pharisees and the Sadducees teaming up over here in chapter 22. So I'm just going to read this out to us. Now, while the Pharisees, in verse 41, were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question saying, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? And they said to him, the son of David. And he said to them, how is it then that David in the spirit calls him Lord? Saying, and then he refers to Psalm 110 over there, you know, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If then David calls him Lord, how is he his son? It's kind of confusing, right? But if then David calls Christ Lord, then how is Christ, the Messiah that you say, is David's son? You know, he's kind of flipping it over here in terms of your logical order of hierarchy, right? And no one was able to answer him a word, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. Now, you know, the immediately preceding context we see in verse 34, when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. Right now, this is how it works, right? In any kind of system that we operate or structure. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him this question to test him. Now, as a man, I don't know, you know, we want to be respected, right? And we have this whole idea of respect. You got to respect me. Don't try and question who I am. Who are you to test me? But we don't, you know, Jesus kind of has a different response. He's kind of not offended by them, right? And we have this kind of division in our culture between love and respect. I don't know, many of you may have that book. A lot of churches have it by Eggleridge on love and respect. Teaches that men need respect and women need love. But subsequently, our research has done that that's a false conclusion, because men and women both equally need love and respect. Right. In fact, she did research among women. Women said, no, we want to be respected, not only loved. Right. So it's kind of crazy. But Jesus, apparently, you might argue, may not be your typical male. Right? He didn't take offense at the question, but he answers the question regarding the great and the first commandment. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Right. So as men, we are invited first to adopt that stance, right? To not take offense at what people try and say. And it's also a lesson in evangelism being one of our strategic priorities. How do we respond? If you're going to continually take offense of what will people think because I'm South Asian or because I'm black and we want to be on the offensive foot, chances are we're not going to get anywhere the way Jesus wants to. And I think here's an important lesson, right? That first, the reason we should not take offense is because we've surrendered everything to Jesus. There's nothing to take offense of. And Jesus had already done that before going to the cross, right? So, now, when the Pharisees and the Sadducees, they were sticklers for the law, right? There were 600 plus laws. And to somehow boil all that down, as we see in the meeting preceding context, He said, all these laws, you know, the first is, love the Lord your God with all your heart and soul and mind, and the second one is like it, you know, love your neighbor as ourselves. Kind of sounds somewhat simplistic. How can you boil down all the 600 laws that we are, our lives are about, our identity, our purpose, you know, why we exist? Now, is just these too simple and somewhat simplistic, the way he's making it out to be? And here comes along Jesus, you know, I mean, he's apparently no respecter of persons. I mean, don't know where he was schooled. I mean, you would think he would know better. Or if not, he might try and act as if he was trying, right, for crying out loud, just like everyone else, or, you know, just try and fit in. Do we really want our men to be different? Are we willing to give ourselves that? Are we willing to step out there like Jesus, you know? Against the norms of society sometimes. And I came across this, you know, and the Pharisees and Sadducees thought they were special. And Jesus in his own way was special. If you have that slide, Robert, if you can go ahead and put it there. It's an acronym. Sense of self-importance, preoccupation with power, beauty, or success. E for entitled. C for can only be around people who are important or special. I, interpersonally exploitative for their own gain. A is arrogant. L, lack empathy. And for me, must be admired. And E, envious of others or believe that others are envious of them. As I kind of read this, and as I kind of thought about the Pharisees and Sadducees and Jesus's, you know, diatribe against them in Matthew 22 and following, calling them hypocrites and really insulting them, right, over there. These are actually the qualities of narcissistic personality disorder. Some of you psychologists might already know that. I got this from a Duke Health blog, right? But both display continuity with scriptures, the Pharisees and Jesus. But Jesus is kind of evidencing a different understanding and a starting point, right? But it also serves to distinguish between the male stereotype and the archetype in Jesus, right? The sense of self-importance. Now, as we think about it, what does it look like for us, right? Where does our sense of self-importance come from? Is it in what we do, how we look? Like the Pharisees, you know, they do all their deeds to be seen by others. But in Jesus, it was himself, the Son of Man, right? Preoccupation with power and beauty. For you are like whitewashed tombs and outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones. Jesus calls it out. And for himself, but you are not called to be a rabbi, for you have one teacher and you are all brothers. And call no man your father on earth, for you have one father who is in heaven. Neither be called instructors, for you are Christ. And so when we think about this idea of man, we're getting a sense here that Jesus' idea of man is something that transcends our social, cultural, biological, physical, spiritual understandings, right? Entitled. Where does our sense of entitlement come from? What do we feel entitled to? Now, we usually use that in a negative way, but even Jesus felt entitled. I mean, he referred to himself as the Son of Man, which was traditionally used for the coming Messiah. He affiliated with that, rather than the titles that the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Can only be around people who are important or special. Now, for the Pharisees and Sadducees, that was important, but even for Jesus, the only thing is he considered everyone equally important and special. Interpersonally exploitive for their own gain. Right? We know that's true for the Pharisees and Sadducees. And for Jesus, the greatest among you shall be your servant. Whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and whoever humbles himself will be exalted. Right? Thanks for that. You can take that down. But as we kind of consider these, I think the scripture is inviting us today to reorient ourselves in terms of a biblical kind of understanding of arrogance. What is the biblical? A lack of empathy, but Jesus was compassionate, right? And so on and so forth. But I'd like to, if you have your Bibles, to turn with me to the Matthew 16 passage. And the reason I go to Matthew 16 is because that's the beginning of the third thematic flow in the Gospel of Matthew, right? When Jesus began to do with these things, you know, that's kind of a turning point. So this whole idea of the Son of Man and Son of God kind of actually goes back to this part, right? And we have these bookends over here. And we see that Jesus and his disciples are in Caesarea Philippi, right? Which is a beautiful place at the foot of Mount Hermon, but obviously it wasn't the kind of territory, Jesus, I mean, what was a very, anti-Christian or anti-Christ kind of environment. It was, full of Baal worship. Alexander the Great, had established it as a pagan city, called it Pan. And Herod had a great temple there built to Caesar Augustus, who had given him the town. And as men, we tend to build our own fortresses and make ourselves king, right? But as men who follow Christ, we find ourselves in Caesarea Philippi with Jesus. And right here, Jesus picks up, he's on different territory, right? And he asks the disciples, who do people say that the Son of Man is? It's interesting, but because the first question, if I was Jesus, I might have asked, well, who do people say that I am? But he doesn't do that. Who do people say that the Son of Man is, right? And I think it's important, what is our reference point for our ministry as men? Do we see ourselves in continuity with the ministry of Jesus historically, right? That's the tradition. It doesn't start with New Creation Church, or doesn't start with the Methodist Church. It doesn't start with what we know as history, right? But it starts beyond that, right? When God set us apart before we were born, right? And you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, right? But who do you say that I am, right? And so Christ is asking us, you and me, I believe, who do you say Jesus is? What is your self-understanding? What is my self-understanding of who Christ is? So it puts the onus on me to actually go back and first be aware of what culture is saying about who God is, right? Because the context for our belief is not devoid of culture. We have to know where we are. What do people in Durham think about who Christ is? So that's the first research assignment for us. Second is, how do you differentiate yourself as a man, or as a woman for us today, right, in Christ? And we see that Peter responds, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. The living God. And we know this is reaffirmed in Corinthians. I tell you this, brothers, Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. So our maleness, if we only going to view it in bodily, physical terms or human sexuality terms, that's certainly not going to be enough, because it's not about flesh and blood. It's not about flesh of my flesh or bone of my bones either, as Adam did, right? When he was taken up, astounded by Eve's presence. Second, in 1 Corinthians 2, Paul writes, these things God has revealed to us through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. And if you haven't done that before, if you haven't asked the Holy Spirit, maybe you've been coming to church, maybe you've been doing the motions, like I am, and I was in several ways, but without the Spirit, it's dead. The rituals are dead, the Bible reading is dead, the prayers are dead, the family is dead, society is dead and dying. Why? Because we read this parable later on, right? We don't have enough oil in the lamps. And when Jesus comes, they'll find those bridesmaids who have to say, hold my spot, I'm going to get some oil. Well, the spot is here right now, people of God. Say, Lord, I want to be filled with your Holy Spirit in a way that's unimaginable, in a way that I've never experienced before. Would you anoint me afresh, O God, with your Holy Spirit? Blessed are you, Son of God. You know, that whole idea, Paul writes on, when he said, Jesus tells Peter, right? Blessed are you, because when you said that, when you admit that, I am the Christ. Because who has revealed that to you? Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Yonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so that's it. For us as men, our identity is not revealed in culture, but it's revealed by God. God has revealed to us that you are the rock, actually, just like Peter. And you are the person whom Christ has called to be a major rock and foundation within the church of God. I'm sorry, I need to look at the guys on the first row, but I want to look to everybody, all of us here this morning, right? But God is calling us men to surrender our solutions and receive that key. Look at it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. What's in your pocket? Do you have the keys? We each. That's the keys of my car. Not going to get me to heaven, right? But here he's saying, you know, I'm going to give you the keys. Now, when I was in school, I was clueless of all this, man. I mean, I wish somebody had told me what this actually meant. You don't have to be wrapped around the next woman you come across with. You don't have to be centered on your family, as culture would make us think. You don't have to be centered on what we make out of church or what we make out of anything else. Your center is Jesus Christ, for crying out loud. If we don't get that, everything else is going to be a mess. Why do we need that? Because he wants to give you and I the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Can you imagine? You and I are given the keys to the kingdom of heaven. That is amazing. I mean, I'm excited. I don't. What does it mean? You know? And then he says, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Men of God, you know, there are people, maybe not in our families here, their families are in mess. Children are astray. Society is going into shambles. The cities we live in that are under your and my watch are crying out. The doors are locked. Who has the keys? Does God have the keys? Sure, God has the keys. Jesus, we know, has the key. In Revelation, we're given that image. But what's he saying over here? You and I have the keys. Am I ready to take that out? Am I ready to wield that sword of the Holy Spirit in our context? And this is what Paul is kind of alluding to, I believe, in Romans, right? For the whole world is waiting in eager anticipation for the revealing of the sons of God. Waiting for us to step into that, irrespective of what age, whether you're 5 years old, or whether you're 25 or 55 or 75 or 85 or 95, right? And I think here we have that beautiful invitation as men. The message we have for the world, our families, our spouses and co-workers is that I am blessed. I am a rock of God. I am an instrument for the revelation of God in this world and the next. I am a solid rock in Christ's church, put in place by Christ, who himself is the chief cornerstone. And if you have a problem with my looks or my talents or my history or my future, you can ask the builder, the chief architect, who is Jesus Christ, because he has said that he will give to you and to me the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And no power of hell, no bill, no work permit, no nothing is going to stand in the way of the power of Christ. And as a man, I am not helpless. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Now we all know that Jesus is not talking about the material things like ropes and chains that bind. These will fade and these will break off with rust and moth, right? But the force of forgiveness lasts forever. Not merely forgiving those who have hurt us. Yes, them for sure. But the attitude that accompanies the authority of forgiveness as a way of life. And Jesus drew our attention to it earlier. You know, blessed are the meek and the poor and the blind. And I believe he is calling you and I to a time of blessing, a turnaround time, you know, where we have the keys, right, to open that door, right? Not only for ourselves, to let the Spirit of God flood into our lives, but for us to step out into the world, to step out in the Caesarea Philippi's of our day and our time, and to give people our worship to Jesus Christ, invite them through our witness, right? And so as we kind of pray, I'm going to read this back, you know, where Matthew kind of goes to chapter 5, where we talk about the Beatitudes. And I want to end with that prayer as we transition into communion. And if you're a man here, can I ask you to stand with me as we pray? And if your family's here, and and if you can think about, you know, the men in your life, you know, since this is Men's Sunday, I'm wondering if we can just take a moment to soak in this. And you can close your eyes and say, Holy Spirit of God, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Let's go ahead and pray this up with me. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. This is our message. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Blessed are the merciful, Lord, for they shall receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. And blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. And dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the mandate, for giving us the keys. And Lord, we want your courage. We want your determination, O Lord. We fail ourselves, O Lord. And so we want to rest and remain and rely upon your power this morning, Lord, to be blessed, Lord, in the way you have imagined it, Lord. To be blessed by becoming poor in our spirits, Lord, but rich in you, Lord. To be blessed, Lord, through our mourning, Lord, because we rejoice on that day when you come, Lord. To be blessed by your meekness, Lord, the hunger and thirst for righteousness. To be merciful, to be pure in heart, body, soul, and mind and our actions. To be peacemakers in our homes and families and neighborhoods, Lord. To stand against, O Lord, evil, O Lord. And those stand with those who are persecuted, Lord, for righteousness' sake. To stand up in our workplaces and our families, Lord. And we thank you for that, Lord. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let me live on. Whoa, whoa, whoa. be alive. I faced danger that I couldn't see. You kept your angels camped all around me. Now I thank you, Lord, I'm still alive. Oh, 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 I am, yes, I am a living testimony. Lord, I could have been dead and gone, yes, I could. Lord, you let me live on. Oh, 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 I am a living testimony. Now, I thank you, Lord, I'm still alive. This old body of mine, with a finger of love, my eyes stay wide open. I said, Lord, I do thank you for just keeping me alive. I could have been dead somewhere sleeping in my grave, but you made open death. Back in the day. That's why I say this, fella. I am, yes, I am, a living testimony. Lord, I could have been dead and gone, but Lord, you let me live on. Oh, 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 I'm a living testimony. Say it again. I thank you, Lord. One more time. I thank you, Lord. I'm still alive.
And so receive this benediction, and I'm going to lay my hand on the pastor so she feels it personally. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and grant you peace. Go in the name of the Lord. God bless you.